get to see a lot of guys, the jumps they make, the older upperclassmen take new roles. You're not in a press situation as far as a game coming up, so you get to, sometimes you see the guys really get to, they feel pressure, but not as much crazy pressure, and they get to really fall into their roles. And spring is a very fun time to experiment, to do things, to work, have a vision for your team, and try to shape it to go that way, and then be able to adjust as they go. Like I say, this team keeps developing its identity, its personality, and, you know, again, we always say fourth quarter drills, but for the most part, went very well. I think early we've tried an educational process, and our goal for the spring, as we keep finding this, that one, it's the quest for the inches. At the end of the day, that's what it's about, finding the inches. I mean, because you look at our seasons, the last seven, whether we won them or lost them, you either found them or you missed those inches. And we're 78-17 in the last 7 years. Like I said, we're one of only two teams to be in the top 25 all 7 years. One of the top two winningest teams in the country. We've got a five-year BCS New Year's Day streak, beat whatever those games are now, whatever you call them. I keep changing on it. But so we've had a lot of success. But at the same time, you know, you got to continue on your success, and you constantly have to remember what you do well, continue to tweak the other avenues of things you don't, and then adjust each of those things to the guys on your football team. Because each year has been a different thing that we've tweaked and turned and you know, featured in different ways. But it's going to be a fun spring, I think. I'm really looking forward to it. And again, from what we've done in mat drills, fourth quarter drills, however you want to call them, been pleased, especially the second half. Guys really got it. And those young guys, about the seven guys that came in, fit in really well. And I think our upperclassmen accepted those guys really well and showed them. And some of those guys at the end, were right there with those guys running. And, you know, we didn't make a mistake on any of those guys, that's for sure. We feel very confident the guys we got, their athletic abilities, and what the upperclassmen showed them how to work. And was very pleased in that regard. So we got a lot of work to do, as always in spring, as all teams do. No matter how many guys, you got 17 starters coming back, but that don't mean you don't have a lot of work to do. I mean, even if I say you're anxious to see the young guys, I am, and I'm anxious to see the old guys. How much they've improved, how many things they've tweaked and turned, and where they see their new roles as, and some of them have to fall into different leadership roles, and you know, be the experienced guy in the huddle now, or on the field, or whatever it may be, and it'll be fun to go. Get some of the guys who were injured in the back last year, that we had quite a few of those guys, getting them back, and you know, some guys that are banged up in the missed spring, I'll talk about in a minute, now, that will be out for spring, and then other guys will have an opportunity to step up. That's all part of football. You get an opportunity, you gotta take advantage of it. But you know, we've been very proud of the things we've been able to accomplish, and what we've been able to do here. But at the same time, you're not growing, you're going backwards, in my opinion. It doesn't work that way. You know, you got to keep moving forward. So we'll tweak and turn and look at the things we need to increase on, and try to keep doing the things we've done well, which have been quite a few things. But we'll have a heck of a schedule coming up, so we need to get ready to go. So, questions?
Jim, when you think about the last time you saw this team, it's been a little bit more than 2 months since you've seen those guys. When do you kind of see, I guess, that change? Is it, you know, a way a certain guy approaches something? Is it something else?
We see it from day one, from the first day, fourth quarter drill start to the day weightlifting starts. I mean, you see, I mean, guys, they know the rules. They had a couple weeks off there, and they come in, and they accept it because they're on a sped-up schedule. Because today's time, kids know that. They're doing it in high school. They're doing it all the way up. Guys know their opportunities and what they see, and the guys don't get passed by. And but you start to see it right off the bat from day one, in my opinion.
Jimbo, how will this spring be different than maybe the last two? 2015, you had a lot of fresh faces. 2016, it seemed like you brought a lot back.
Everybody says, how is it going to be different? Here's what I always say, just like the players say, Coach, you say the same things all the time. I say, when the reasons for success change, I'll quit saying the same things. Because at the end of the day, when the reasons for success change in football, springs will change. And what I mean by that is, we got to be able to play the run, got to be able to run the football. Got to be able to stop, not have turnovers. Got to be able to create turnovers. Got to be able to make big plays. Got to be able to stop big plays. We're one of the top two in the last 7 years. We're one of the top two or three teams in the country creating big plays. We're averaging over 36.5 points a game. So you got to be able to score and do those things. You have to play great red zone offense, which we were number one in the country and have been for the last 7 years. You have to come defense. We end up being very good on red zone at the end. It'll be a great third down team. We're a very solid third down team converting. We got to get off the field, you know, on the other end of it. So the things that make you have success, as far as those will still be the things that are emphasized, done over and over and over and over, because they're the reason that you have success. But as far as different, practice schedules will be different. Maybe we'll tweak and turn a scheme on defense, schemes on offense, how we block something, new routes, new combinations, or new things that have evolved coverage-wise or blitz-wise, or we have to go against things that we look at our opponents things that they're doing differently by what they're doing, but the drills and things won't, but what is made feature at times, you know, the blitzes Miami has, or the blitzes Alabama has, or the blitzes Clemson have, or the blitzes Florida have, or the blitzes Louisville have, or whoever, you know, that opponent may be, you know, North Carolina State, or Wake, I mean, all those guys, they all bring different things. From that point, we've already broken those down, and we'll feature those in our spring to get guys introduced to those kind of things, but the base thing of what you do will stay very simple.
Do you tailor the practices at all based on the type of varsity you have to try to reach some of those goals that you mentioned before?
Oh, no doubt. And what do you think as you go, where it's you're deficient at or where you're not deficient at? Without a doubt, we can turn. But at the same time, when you go work on all the things that you do poorly, what you do, you get away from the things you do well. And all of a sudden, you don't do those well anymore. You got to continue to do the things you do well and gradually get better at the things you don't do well. Everybody says, well, go fix that. Well, I can go work on that all day, and I don't practice what we do well, guess where that's going to go? You know, man, it's like cutting one side of the yard. That side of the yard looks pretty. Go work on the other side of the yard. Well, if you ignore that side of the yard, what's it look like? Same thing as the other side look like. I mean, so there's a fine line in there about how you got to do that. But we will do it. Issues and things that we need to tweak and turn, we definitely will do that.
Fourth quarter drills, I know
it's
a lot about conditioning, but how much of it is about competing?
It's all about competing. Competing, mental toughness. And that's why I say that's where the inches are found. The motto of what we always talk about, toughness, mental, physical, effort, discipline, and pride. Those aren't just words. That's how you get things done. And like I say, you're a 54-yard field goal on a play in a Clemson game, 2 or 3 inches here and there. Find the inches. How you cut a drill. How you make a cut. How often can you sink my foot and round that thing without going outside the cone that far? Maybe if I go inside that far, now I cut that guy off on the play. Or I get in front of him to make the catch. Or I make in front of him to make the tackle. Football is such a game of inches, and everybody says it's cliche. It's not. Go watch the film. And then a lot of times, even when you were having success, we were undefeated, and all teams are. If you watch it, the fine line between winning and losing is always those inches. And that's what we tried to really emphasize. You know, we even went through, we even changed how we did fourth quarter this year. By rating guys, we always told them what they did. We rated them every day. You come out in the Garnet jersey, you're giving championship effort. Everybody had your thumbs up and all the drills. You never took a playoff. You come out in white, you're average. That may have been you took two plays off. Boom, you're average. And if you're not giving any kind of effort at all and things that we think is ridiculous, you wear orange. I mean, so that way, and you called and you had to wear and work out in that jersey that day. Cause trying to point out what, because guys said, well, coach, you don't tell me. You don't tell me. I'm telling you every day. This is it. What you're going to do, how you're going to do it. It's not, sometimes it's effort. Sometimes it's hand on the line, hand behind the line. Every tweak and turn, finish every play, not one play off. And it's things you've always done, it's things we've never done, we've done this in the past. But I think it's very good, especially with kids today. I think the more you show them, I said with kids at any age, in any time, 25 years ago, I think that's what we did a better job of at the time. Now we tell them it's all kumbaya and s'mores by the campfire and how everything nice is. Back in the day, they told you when you were wrong and showed you when you were wrong. That's what we're trying to do. Educate the kids on the effort, the discipline, the toughness, all the things in which we want to do. And how we want it done, and define it definitively.
How'd you come up with orange jersey?
Well, you look at it, that's not always a good color around here, is it?
How did you see guys kind of respond to...
Really good, because they got called out by their peers. I mean, it wasn't like, you know, hey, man, he's doing me right now. What jersey are you in? I know, I'm just doing that on purpose, just to mess with you. And then guys start watching guys. We had it on film. Your video, the thing that when we watched the video, we did think, right? Show them a good, this is what effort is. This is not what, this is what discipline is. This is what the proper technique is. This is what, you know, of the drills and what you do. And then some are, you know, they're not winning football positions or anything like that. It was all effort, but this is what we're teaching you. Do whatever it is. And if you do that, you'll create a habit of doing it on the football field.
So the color jersey thing, is it kind of collaborative between the coaches and the players?
No. They don't get no vote. They don't know what they got. It's just coaches.
Why did you want to do that?
I've done it in the past.
Oh, yeah.
I've done it in the past. I've done it in different teams I've been on and different schools I've been at. And it was very helpful because it defines it. And the kid, you know the worst thing? They'll argue with it. It's like, man, coach is doing me wrong. Teacher doing me wrong. Wait a minute. That guy's counting on me. My buddy, I'm in an orange and he's in a garnet. You know how many friends you get in those orange jerseys? Or whatever that color may be, you don't get many. Because you know why? Guys are here for business. They understand what it is. They can be friends, but on the field, they're going, who you can count on. And I want to show the guys on the field who you can count on every play. that's something that's been done in different schools I was at. When I brought it back out, I thought it was very helpful and educational. Not because I think we'll always do it. I think because when you continue to always show kids consistently, I think it takes all the guesswork. What do I got to do? All right, this is it. Here's the example of three plays that you didn't do. Now do it. And all of a sudden, it was amazing. At the end, we probably had, I'm going to say, we had no oranges. And I'm going to say, I'm going to estimate probably 85 to 90% garnet. And it went up each time. Now we'd go, and sometimes they would take a step back. And that was the ones I was worse on. Because the worst thing for a coach is to count on somebody, count on somebody, count on somebody. And all of a sudden, when it's biggest moment, he picked that day to take off. And once you cross that line, the goal was, if you ever go back, you're going all the way back. And to show them. And I can tell them in life, how many people you want to count on? You know every time you come to see me, I'm going to be there. Well, one time I'm ahead of you. Go do what you want to do. That's what you do. That's what you do when you don't play hard. Or you don't have the right discipline. Or you don't line up right. Or you don't learn your assignment. Or you don't go to class. Class and everything's involved in that. Now, what you do on the field, off the field, everything you do, it's a constant educational process. And don't blame anybody else. I got to tell them all the time. You're not born a winner. You're not born a loser. You're born a chooser. Choose what you're going to do.
Jimbo, the fact that you were 85, 90% garnet at the end of winter conditions.
That means we got a long way to go.
Then is there any concern that as you start spring, because at the start of last spring, you were really unhappy with the
No, we're farther along now than we were in that by far.
Why do you think that is? That you're further along?
No, we educated them.
Coach, do you come into spring looking at players and have players in your mind that you think are going to step up and replace the ones that have left? Mm-hmm.
But I don't also cloud my vision and become tunnel vision where I can only see them. Because I want to see, you got to go out there and do it. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you have vision of what you want guys to do, and you can talk to them, put them in position to do it. But I also don't see things through a straw. Keep my wide eyes and see other guys develop. Don't take that off, you know what I mean? And see who can go out there and process and play every day. Because sometimes even the guys out there, that doesn't mean that doesn't mean you're a good player. That means you have a chance. Without that, you have no chance.
This is the first year in a little while that you have your starting quarterback. Just how is going into spring with that stability is?
Well, I mean, it's good if he continues to grow. See, I mean, that's what I was saying. We said, well, does he take the next step? Does he take the next three step, whatever it may be? How far does he keep progressing? And that's at every position. I mean, no matter how many starters you got back, sometimes the worst springs I've ever been a part of in the past, we had a lot of guys back because they all think they can take it off. You know what I mean? And I spring, yes, it is. But we're not going to do that. We're going to make sure we get better in every aspect.
Last year, you know, when we spoke to you start spring, you were talking about – you know, what you saw from the X guy, Y guy, this and that. Today, you're kind of preaching more of this message of accountability. I mean, what for you makes it so important to get that point across, talking about accountability as well as just...
Because that's what relates to winning. That's the reason you have success. Sometimes the coach, you got to go back to day one, you got to prove it. Even if you're a guy that started 3 years, you got to prove it tomorrow. The score of every game is 0-0. They don't give you any points. So you got to do it every time. You're making them understand that. And I think if they can understand that, they're going to be more successful in life. I truly believe that. And I would, going back to, you know, the individuals are good, but you have some individual great efforts, but that don't win you a championship.
You have an offensive line, you guys lost a couple starters, you got a couple guys out with injuries. How's that competition going to be this spring among all those five spots?
Well, I don't know. It'll be gone. Like I said, I'll just go through real quick before we get into who's out in the spring. Before we get into that, I'm going to clean my glasses, I can tell you nothing. You did that, didn't you?
I did.
All right. Dawsey, he had a big spur taken off his toe. Got told Dickerson with his ACL, Everly with the hip surgery, Kerr with the shoulder, Marcus Lewis with his hip, and McFadden with the shoulder. Yeah. And then as of out right now, depending on how they, I mean, probably not out for the whole spring, but the Shamar Kibber Lane's got a real bad turf toe. Lane, he had that foot surgery on that outside bone in his foot. He may be back by the second half of spring or again, I don't know. It's got to be. Robbins actually pulled a hamstring, and it was shame because he's been doing extremely well in the second half of last year. We were very pleased with him. Pulled a ham, so probably this week and next week, he'll probably be out the rest of this week, but then with next week, we expect him to be back the last 12 days of spring. Torres with his leg surgery and that, and then Wilson Bell will be taking, Wilson Bell will be graduating, and then transferring.
Who's in play at left tackle?
or two or three different guys that you're looking at?
Right now, who's had an outstanding camp? I mean, tremendous. It's really, and then it's about time. That's what I thought would happen, is Ethan Frith. Chris having a great time there. I mean, played really well as far as this offseason strength and what he's doing. He'll get a first shot there. Ball, Juwan, and then you got Brock, or you can move Ricky over if you have to. You know what I'm saying? What we're doing. So you got plenty there. But Frith right now will start off right there.
The play does leave Rick Leonard playing over, right?
Right, as of right now. As of right now. We'll wait and see. But no reason. He played very well there. Got very comfortable. No reason to make him learn something all the way new either. And in college football, everybody makes a big deal about the left tackles. It's not the same as it is in pro football. It's good because ends flip-flop. Guys don't play right and left very often. Like Mark, you saw him on both sides. You know what I'm saying? All your big pass. They don't do it like they do pro football. The ball's not always in the middle of the field like it is in pro football.
Jimbo, Derwin wasn't on that list, so he's good for all the girls.
Oh, yeah, Derwin's been pretty wide open. He's been going. Derwin's been full go.
Well, I mean, to have Derwin back in practice, just his personality, having that guy.
He's been good in offseason, so we'll find out. Again, he's got to go out there and prove it again, too. What he's done in the past, that's great. Got to go do it again, which I expect him to do that.
Is he different as a person from what he was before the injury to what he is today?
Not really. I don't think he is. I really don't. I mean, he may on his own realize how quick things can go away. You know what I'm saying? You have to ask him that. But I haven't seen any change. He's been the same Derwin. I mean, more mature. I mean, as he's grown, which is not that he was immature, but I mean, you see him growing, you know, in his roles and things that are going on. But I think he's very similar.
Jimbo, you said if you're not growing, you're going backwards. How have you grown as a coach since last year, or from last year?
Probably about 5 or 8 pounds. Outward, a little bit on the side. That's trying to get that back off right now. I don't know. We'll find out. Hopefully, have better organization. Hopefully, you see your team better. Hope you tweak teams. Hope you handle people better. Hope you do a lot of things. I mean, you're always just like a player. You're trying to look at every aspect of what you do as a coach, whether it's offense, defense, special team. A lot of things y'all don't ever see. How you handle your staff. How you do things behind the scenes. How you deal with recruiting. How you deal with personal situations. With your team, how you manage the discipline, how you manage school, I mean, all those things. I mean, there's so many. Coaching, there's not many people in the world probably wear more hats than we do when you get right down to it. So there's a ton of things you may not be seen outwardly, but hopefully that your organization. And the good thing about it is, are your players doing well? Are you winning games? Are you graduating your players? Are they going to school? And are you producing guys in the NFL and doing the things you need to do? And it seems like we're doing that in all aspects of what we're doing in our program.
We've talked a lot about quarterbacks in the last few years, but as far as the role for backup quarterback, what progress have you seen from the three guys in camp right now? Well, three guys right now.
We haven't. I mean, they're all working hard. They're all working their tails off, but they'll have to go out on the field and do it. Very excited what J.J. and Bailey, Jake Rizzo, you know, see all those guys doing this for a knowledge team.
Jimbo, you said you'll incorporate some things that your opponents do, but with Alabama being the first game of the year, would you put any more attention on getting ready for Alabama than
no?
Jimbo, George Campbell missed all of last year. How have you seen him do?
Good. I mean, getting back healthy. He's right on. He'll practice and go all the way, but I think he'll have some sore days because he's right on that fringe of when he's trying to release to how he's healing up. But he's been doing good. Then the offseason, we'd work him 3 or 4 days, give him a day, let him gradually heal, but he'll be great. Glad to get him back out there.
Devontae Phillips, he had groin surgery.
That was a long time ago. He had an ankle that bothered him all last year. He had a high ankle sprain. He got it really bad. But that's finally healing up pretty good.
Jimmy, you got 7 guys from the 17 class 40 at school. You got season. How are those guys shaping?
I said I was very pleased. We didn't miss on any of those guys. I mean, very happy with their athletic ability. Also, all are doing really well in school. I mean, really well. Great students, doing where they're supposed to be, being dependable people, reliable people, and then coming out there working their tails off have been outstanding young men. I mean, we're very excited with all those guys.
Any of them flashing you early on?
All of them. I'm serious. And I don't joke. They all have. I mean, they fit. They look like they've been there a couple of years. I mean, those guys all fit in and running and drills. And they had to learn early, but I mean, they've done a great job adapting and fitting right in.
With Marquez gone, Tavares and Marcus both out, kind of opportunity there for guys in the secondary.
Oh, but you got to remember how many guys you played last year. When you look at that list right here, and when you really go look at it, man, quarterback Malik, because Tavares is out, Mark, you got Levante Taylor, you got Kyle Myers, you got Becker, and you got Sanders. I mean, that's another guy, you know. Becker, when he's long jump the other day for 25 feet, I think in a meet. So he's going to be an excellent guy right there in that group. And then in the secondary, with Nate, Trey, Derwin, Irvin being out a little bit, AJ, Bruton, and then Fagan. I mean, it's going to be, it's great numbers you got there. You know, you're going to lose a bunch after this year probably, but that's going to be an interesting battle. So it's fun to watch. But also, you're playing five, six, seven DBs at times now. You've got to have what I like is a lot of different body types, abilities, you know what I mean, quickness, length, size, outright speed. I think you can match up pretty well. So, you know, your secondary guys have to be very diverse, in my opinion. So I'm anxious for the depth we have. It should be a really good group.
Having Nate come back for a fifth year, how important is that?
Well, I think for him, one, because Nate looked ball was a shame he got hurt. But getting, you know, you don't, in today's time, you don't get many fifth-year seniors. Those days are far and few between. You go back and think about it. Because, I mean, there's only 13 seniors on this team. There's only 13 scholarship seniors on this team. You break it down. So, I mean, getting seniors in general, let alone a fifth-year senior, that didn't happen very often. So, it's big, and we're glad to have him because Nate's been a super player for us. And more importantly, he's a super guy. Great leader.
With those senior numbers kind of really thin the last couple of seasons,
it's always going to be that way.
Yeah, it's
the way of the world. When you roll your team over, you're rolling your two, three and outs, and all the things that go on. That's just the nature of the world today. Like I say, back in the old days, people say, and I say this all the time. Right now, by the time most of them, with their experience, meets the talent, where they could really be that great, great, great player every play instead of having those couple knucklehead plays anymore, they leave. You know what I'm saying? And that's just the way it is. I mean, you got to. That's why I say off-field hires, off-field preparation, off-field development, all the things, and being able to have a staff of people that can do things. Not anything illegal, but being able to watch film, get cutouts. I mean, do the different things that you got to do to help develop kids in today's time. The quicker you can develop them, you've got to speed that process up because they sped your process up. The old day, my redshirt, my take care of. A lot of those guys, even though they're great talents, are still not ready to play great football. And I think that's where we get confused. And I think the teams that have that off-field grouping of people that are committed to that, I think it makes it much more cohesive for them to be able to fit in and play early and play well early. Because that's the key, not just playing early, but how well do you play? Do you play well enough to win games or well enough to win a championship? That's a different deal. And it becomes very tough.
How would you start off with the defensive ends and in terms of the strong side?
No, I mean, when you look at him right here, I mean, Sweat, see, people don't realize Sweat can play the run. He can pass rush, but Sweat is powerful. Sweat plays the run extremely well. You have Burr on that, you know, in that group. You can keep him in there. Wilkerson will be a big end in there. Robinson's a big end. And Kendo can go back and forth in that whole group. So, I mean, he's a rush end, but also Kendo, you know, he's 240-some pounds, but, I mean, he is strong. He's going to be a big, big guy. You got the ability to mix all those guys around.
You were really high on Keith Bryant coming into last spring that he was.
He ain't been hurt off, and he's still been banged up. He hadn't been through much of the offseason workouts. He's had a foot, some core things, unfortunately, been banged up. So we'll have to wait and see what happens this spring.
As a pass rusher, I think Josh had 4.5 sacks over his last three games. Was there anything different with him late in the year as to why he was.
Probably health, much as anything. I mean, yeah, remember at the end of the year, he was banged and bruised, and he had that surgery. I mean, that's in week three, and you keep playing. He's playing what you got. I mean, that's what you do. People say, well, no, that's when you're always going to be banging rules in football. And so I think then, you know, start combining the moves with the health and feeling good and getting a burst and playing all of his assignments and just and growing. I mean, and Josh is a sophomore. Second half of his sophomore year, you start processing that out, you know what I mean, and playing really well. And we're very pleased with him.
Jim, are you happy to have the spring game back here in Tallahassee?
Yeah, I am. I think it's good. I mean, I didn't mind it where it was. But at the same time, when all those kids come to your spring game and a recruiting deal, you're not on this campus. I mean, there's a negative to that, too. It's great to take it, but it's also great when that spring game and they get to your campus and they get to see everything. There's a big advantage to that, especially when kids come from far off. Because a lot of times, that's the only chance they ever get to come. A lot of them, and if they don't get to come to your campus, you miss out a lot of recruiting on that process.
Jim, I just want to get back to Josh real quick. After the North Carolina game, he felt responsible for the lazy label. He took it kind of to heart.
All of them.
Yeah. Did you see
they should have
a big difference in him afterward, though?
Yeah. I mean, because it was education. Mm-hmm. It's funny when you really see it on film and you see that, and it may be one, guys, and everybody acts like it was every play. It may have been three or four plays, but you can't, three or four, it's just as detrimental as every one. Because you don't know what play changes the game. And that's the thing with young players. That's why people have, I keep saying, when they're finally their mental maturity matches their physical skills, then you have a great player. And it's not their fault when they don't do it as a young group because they're not mature enough. They don't always understand that. People say, well, guys, they're kids. They're 18, 19, 20-year-old kids, and people don't understand it. And that's part of a growing process in everything you do. Every play, every second of everything you do. And once you educate them and show them, then they see it. Because you know why? He's a great kid, and he's a very intelligent guy, and he's a very caring guy. He's going to be a heck of a football player, and he's a heck of a football player.
When that happened last year, did you question yourself at all? Like, is my message not getting through?
Yeah, I question myself every day. I question my message. Because in today's time, why do you think you bring in so many different speakers in a preseason camp? Why do you bring in different people to send a message? Just like now. When I talk to y'all, y'all interpret it all differently. Because y'all don't write the same story. Y'all take one part of it you heard and write your own way. You go one way, you go one way, you go one way, you go one way. Whatever serves what you need. Players are the same way. They hear, when you're 18, they have selective hearing. They hear what they want to hear. And they got 38 people in their ear at home, and then somebody from home, and a coach. I mean, they got all kinds. The amount of, and then they're on Twitter, and they're on Facebook, and everybody's telling them that, you guys don't think that all matters? You're crazy. And all these kids get this information 10 times is not always good. Being able to hear one voice and understand it. So you say things the same way, three different ways. Because maybe it resonates a different way. You have somebody else say, how many times have you sent and told your kid to do something and not do it, and a neighbor comes over and says do it, and they do it? Why is that? What's the difference? They're in the difference. So I'm saying to your question, all right, obviously that didn't get through to them. So how do I get through to them? It's not, I'm not mad at them. I'm not, how do I get through to you? You know what I'm saying? Like some of y'all still don't get the message. You're still hard-headed. You're hard-headed as a daggone players. But I say that jokingly, but it is. Think about it. When we leave here, there'll be, everybody will write a different article. You heard something different. When you talk to a group of people, you ever talk to hear a speaker talk? So there's usually a couple points that really resonate. But then everybody takes something different from it. You know what I'm saying? So you constantly, that's why you got to say it over and over and over and over. And I always say this to my dad. He never thought I'd listen to him at all either. And now everything I do, man, what would he do? He would have done that in that situation. It echoes back. And the more you just pound it in, pound it in, pound it in. And that's why in today's time, again, I'm preaching again, but when you're playing so many young players, and you're rolling your team over so many ways. That's why, coaches, we have sleepless nights because are they really getting, you know what I'm saying? And at our level, when you're playing it at the level for us, one game is a difference of the season or not the season. You know what I'm saying? And so you're constantly trying to question everything you say to them. And that's why you're constantly on those kids saying it or having other people say it to them, saying it a different way, bringing a different speaker to get that one message across. You know, you bring in old Hall of Famers. You bring in... like Dr. Elko and Trevor and those guys. That's why those guys and the off-field people are so important to today's kids. And it used to be they could come sit in your office 24 hours a day. Can't do that no more. That's a violation. So you ain't allowed around them. You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, there's so many different ways and things, but we got to be accountable for them. And they're playing at a younger age. Because back in the day, they didn't get to play until there was an urgency when they were redshirt juniors. When you get to that time, what do you say? Man, my clock's ticking. I better do what? I better pay attention. It's like I got an F in this class, it's midterm, so what's that second half of the semester usually be? They crank it up and make a B or C. You know what I'm saying? I'm just saying, people do it. When you got to the urgency, that's the thing that I think in today, and today's youth doesn't have urgency. They have it about where they want to go and what they want to do, but they don't always have it in work ethic. And I think it's a big downfall. And that's one of the huge challenges for coaches today, is to finding that message and get it resonated across. And that's where your team and your upperclassmen really have to come into play.
Hey, can that start? Will you see that today?
I hope so. And that's why I went in this offseason. Those are things that the more I can educate them and visually show them. Because most athletes are visual learners. If you ever go back and you research in their history of their learning capabilities, because athletics is all what? Done with your eyes. If you can't see it, you can't make the play. I don't care what how good a player you are. If you have bad eyes, you ain't play. Don't see the play, you can't make the play. So my point is, I've thought of different ways to visually show them who I think has effort. This is what I want. This is not what I want. That's a tweak or a turn that we've done. You know what I mean? To constantly go back to some old school ways. We did that 20 years ago. Sometimes those things work. Trying to find that as much as you can. And I hopefully we'll see it today. If we don't, I won't have a fit.
Jimbo, the combine just finished. What would you say to a scout who questioned Dalvin's times in any of the events?
Turn the tape on. How come all them fast guys couldn't catch him? How do they run away from all those guys? See, a combine guys, we make too much of the combine. All the combine does is reassure. They're going to watch the tape. That's the main thing. And they're going to look at it, and it's going to and if there's a glaring thing that jumps out and says, oh, no, there's something there, okay. But what all it does, usually you don't really go up in the combine by great deals. You usually drop more. You know what I'm saying? But his numbers, 4 or 5 is really fast. Okay? All those, I know y'all in Rivals and all this recruiting stuff, y'all believe all those 4.3s and 4.2s and 4.4s? I'll give you some numbers. You know what the average in the last 17 years? You know what the average DB time is with DBs? 4.49. You know what it is in backs? 4.56. You know what it is in tight ends? Like 4.78. You know what it is in linebackers? Like 4.7 something. 4.72 outside backers. Inside backers like 4.8. DN is around 4.6 something. You know what I mean? All those blown up numbers, I'm talking about real electronic numbers. We've been recruiting. It's amazing. Kid's the fastest he ever is when he's 16. It's the fastest they ever are. Just read the recruiting report.
Coach, going along with Dalvin, obviously his talent, but this time of year, what were you missing most about? It's kind of competitive nature that he brought this time of year.
I don't know. I just saw him down in the weight room. I was giving him a hard time. Giving me a hard time. No, but just the smile and knowing, again, what I was going to get every day. Guys, there's nothing more satisfying as a coach to know when that guy walks in the room or he walks on the practice field or he walks in the meeting room, what you're going to get every day. And you can count on it. That gives back to the accountability. As much as anything, the examples of what he did. I mean, the leadership, the yards, the plays. But you knew what you're going to get every day. And if you didn't, all you had to do was walk by and whisper something. Just set him off. He'd look at you. Like I told you that day when he said, coach me like I'm a freshman again. That's what I mean, as much as anything.
Have you seen anybody try to step up? And obviously, the talent's going to be hard to play. But in that group, who's kind of stepped up in this?
They've all done well. We'll find out. I mean, they've all done well in the offseason, but we'll see when they get out there with 11-on-11 and how they play.
Last spring, we saw guys like Dalvin and DeMarcus kind of take players under the wing, use last season as motivation. Who are some players that kind of,
I think we got some excellent leadership guys in now. I mean, I see Sweat them doing it. I see Sweat doing that at times. I see, you know, Derwin, really good. Trey Marshall, Nate, those guys are really good. They set a good state. You know, I'm trying to get back through here. Nottie's been a good leader. Go back through it. Red Derrick's a quiet guy. Matthew's done some good things. Logan Tyler's really athletic. He does a good job leading. I mean, you think the kicker, but he does. DeAndre's done an excellent job. He and Izzo's another guy. You talk about Mr. Steadhead. You know, everything you get done the right way, done in full speed, puts his heart and soul into everything he does. Ryan Izzo does it as good as anybody. DeAndre, same way. You know, Ryan Green's had a really good camp. I'm anxious to watch Ryan. I really am. I'm anxious to see Ricky Leonard's stepping up in the offensive line. Because now, he was trying to fill his way as a player, but now he feels good when you see him, not only by example, by, you know, open his mouth. Of course, Everly did a good job of that, but, you know, being out, it's tougher to do it that way. I'm going through it and make sure I don't miss anybody. Dickerson will be that guy. He does those things. That plays at the receiver position. Those three older guys that play, I mean, two older guys that played a lot, have done a good job. Keith had an outstanding camp. I've been very pleased with him. So, we'll see. Good question, guys. But we'll see.
One more. Jimbo, just following up on McFadden, left or right shoulder, and what exactly?
He had a labrum. He played with it all year. He had it all year.
Torn labrum, you said?
It wasn't a bad thing. It was torn, and we just wanted to go ahead and fix it. There's no mess. It was going to be a problem. You know what I'm saying? To get it now and get it in the offseason.
Do you remember if it's left or right? You remember that it's left or right?
I don't off the top of my head. I don't. I mean, I say it off the top of my head. I don't. I'm trying to think which. I want to say. Right, if I say it, it'd be wrong. I can't remember. I'm trying to remember which way he had his arm was slinging. I'm trying to remember which arm was up. But you see so many of them, that stuff, you know what I mean? That's just part of things cleaned up, fixed up.
All right, well, I'll keep calling Zach till he's.
You'll see him out there today. See which one he's. I don't know if he's out of sling now.
Jimbo, in terms of the running back, Would you like to see one guy kind of break out, or kind of like your first 4 or 5 years where it's a group of two or three?
Well, you always have. No, we had breakout guys in that group. We had other guys. We had as many guys we felt confident putting in. And we did with Jock West. It was just a weird deal with Dalvin. He could create so many big plays that he could do that. You know what I'm saying? So from that standpoint, we did it. But you love to have a great guy. I mean, one guy to jump out. But you're also going to know the running back. You have to have a stable guy. You're always going to have that. I mean, so that's just something we'll constantly just continue to grow. That's a position that we've always done that way. Yeah, he had, but he'll be in spring. He'll be in non-contact early, but going full speed. And he's had a really good camp. He's running really good. He's been very pleased with his offseason. But he'll be in a non-contact early, and we'll see at the end of spring if he does or doesn't. But he's been very pleased with him. Very pleased with his progress. He can run now.
Does he give you kind of like a different look on the backfield? You can catch passes out there.
Oh, he got great hands. Nice. People don't realize he's 212 pounds too now, but he's 212. He's a big guy. Run, catch, very smooth.
With Eberle out, who kind of fills in at center other than Baselli?
We'll have Bavion, Baselli, and Martinez. All those guys. They're nursing that. And Bavion and Baselli are getting over ankle injuries that were non-football related. One on a trampoline and one goofing around with one of his players' horse wrestling turning ankle. But they've been out. They've been bothered to carry it for the last 3 or 4 weeks, but we'll be out here practice. Band of trampoline.
We used to wrestle on those back in the day. On the big
wrestling where you fall off. Yeah, you basically go jump, do flips, and you had fun. Now it's kind of the deal. Anybody else get anything?